Hi. My talk is about OpenQA and how it works in the background. My plan was to have this in a line of OpenQA talks that pile up from beginners to expert. I somehow ended up being the first talk at all in a conference. So let's see how this works out. About me, I'm Stefan Kuhlo. I worked for SUSE for a long time. I was the release manager of OpenSUSE until the release of Leap 42.1. And currently I'm acting as OpenQA architect and test automation champion, or however you want to name it. In my private life, I have two kids that I'm trying to teach free software. No, I don't. This talk will be about things you might not yet know about OpenQA, the architecture on how the whole system works internally, and implementation details that would, if you know them, make you a better test driver in OpenQA. So you see, this is already I require some knowledge about OpenQA, so I will not have a beginner's guide on how to write tests, and I will not, you can still stay here if you don't know shit about OpenQA. I try to have some introduction, but I might lose you quickly, so let's see. So OpenQA started in 2010 by Bernhard Wiedemann, our Kamerakind, to create videos from OpenSUSE installations, and the name ISO2Video still sticks from that time. End of 2011 was the first release of OpenQA. You can still find it in the archives of newsopensuse.org. But back then it was still mainly a tool for Bernhard and some selected others to create better bug reports. This is how it looked like. So it was, if you know OpenQA now, it is not so much different. And actually some of the features that are on the left are we are currently re-implementing to track closed bug reports. So this is how it currently looks like. So it's still about GNOME and KDE tests, if you compare. It's very hard to read, but trust me, it's about desktop tests. Good. The architecture is nowadays mainly about one central web interface, which contains a classic web application that has HTTP and a REST interface for an API. And all users use this as an entrance point to the whole system. There's some scheduler. There's some scheduler that keeps the jobs rotated between the workers, and there's a database, and all these three components communicate through dbus within one VM that I labeled here web UI. And then you have what I tried to express on the right, several workers that connect to this service and take jobs and run the OpenQA tests. One of these workers, I zoomed in at the bottom. You have several instances of a process called ISO2Video running. This one splits into three in between. We have one test runner that actually runs the Perl tests. You have one commands server that takes commands from the outside, including the system under test and the web UI. In case you're using the interactive mode of the web UI. And then there is the actual backend, which can fork several other processes, including QEMU or libvirt commands, or in case of S390, support an X3270 terminal or IPMI commands. So the backends are actually the real really should slow down. I was worried that I would have too many slides, but the backends are the real troublemakers. They share some common properties. One of them is that they can talk VNC. One of them is that they can that they are able to power management the system under test. In QA mode, this is really easy because if you can just start and stop QA mode. But if you're talking about an S390 guest or an IPMI controlled hardware metal, this is more complicated. And the third one is, in our case, that we want to have access to the serial console to be able to have better console tests. The main backend still use is QEMU using KVM. And this QEMU one can emulate a lot of hardware setups. We have, for example, we have one case where we emulate a specific Dell laptop. We can have UEFI BIOSes, we have legacy BIOSes, we have several I/O bus systems, we have IDE, SCSI, we have NVMe lately, we can emulate a RAID system, a software RAID, we can have multipath and so on. This can be all, we can all emulate this just with QEMU. Now let me continue talking about backends for a while. But we also have other backends that, for example, connect to a libvirt domain or no a host through SSH, so it can be actually everything. We have Hyper-V support through a VNC hop implemented. We have some S390 already mentioned. These are all invisible to the test driver because the tests do the very same thing, unless you're very specific, for example, reboot, but all the other stuff is done through a very generic API. And one core component is the needle matching that I would like to dig into further. Then a needle is a region of interest in a reference screen. Most of you that are right in this talk will know that already. But to give you an example, this is actually the pop-up that happens when you press F6, I think, on an OpenSUSE installation. It gives you a way to edit the HTTP installation URL. But this is actually only a zoom in, and the web UI will actually gray out everything else that is not of interest. So, but let's give you a more detailed example. This, for example, is a quite old KDE screenshot with an X term started. So this is, we have the test driver wanted to verify that the X term actually started. So he had a reference screen, and this reference screen contains a region of interest, and that is this region that is not grayed out here. This is the part that identifies the screen as the X term has finished starting. The rest is not of interest. So this is the needle. This is what we call the needle. So, and if I go now on another screen where you don't have KDE, but still there's an X term started, we are asking OpenQA to assert that there's an X term started by means of having assert screen X term. And OpenQA would look at this screen, and the first thing it does is it grays out the screen to 16 shades of gray and blurs the whole thing. I'm not sure how visible the difference is from there behind, but this is the clear picture and this is the blurred picture. I guess from behind it's not obvious, but it's so basically OpenQA looks at the screen as a very old snake. It's not Some people think that OpenQA compares pixels by pixels, but it's not even close to that. The next thing it will do is look at this great grayed out blurred screen to identify the most likely spot that the needle is. So this is some brain dump of OpenQA, let's say. The whiter the pixel is, the more likely it contains the region of interest. What is invisible to the human eye is that it's actually exactly there where we had it, the highest value. And what we are doing with this information is we're going through the likely spots and evaluating the actual pixel diff of this 16 shades of gray. And the number of differences we see in these areas is counted and weighted. So we are not taking every error as an error, but we look on how big the area was and how many differences we saw. So the larger the area, the more forgiving OpenQA is to differences. And then we have some, let's say, magic formula that decides how many percentages this correlates to. This formula has grown over the time because we changed it. We changed the algorithm after we had tons of needles, so we had to adopt the formula to look like the old system, but it was still give out similar match numbers. But in this very X-term example, so you have Bernhard on the screen, always, actually. on the left, you have the KDE screenshot. On the right, you have the GNOME screenshot, only blurred, grayscaled, the region of interest. And the brain dump of OpenQA says it's completely black. So the difference is exactly zero at every pixel, so it's 100% match. Any questions so far? Good. So, what I think that is inherited from here is that big changes are obviously problematic, but what is not so obvious is that small changes to layouts can create quite some noise in the pixel diffs. So one prominent example is if we change the fonts or the font weighting or the font spacing or you name it, the difference to the user is minimal. It is just the L is written small differently or the S moves closer to the T, or it's very tiny changes most often, but many pixels change because the follow-up letters move too, but if the S moves closer to the T. So this is in 12.3 screenshot, and if I flip the fourth and back, you will ignore the left side, but only concentrate on the license part. You might spot the difference if I do this, but if I asked you which it is which, it's already getting complicated. So, but to OpenQA, it is a difference. Here we have the same exercise again, on the left side before, right side after. And now I was not really sure how it is visible, but the pixel differences at the bottom contains quite some noise. Is this visible? I see nodding, so this is a 34% match. This is how it looks like on OpenQA internally. Good. Okay. The S-Hertz screen is For GUI testing or for installation tests, the most common call actually, but it is important to understand that test code is blocking code. So in your test, you do not care what happens to the system under test. You're only writing the asserts or the commands. And in between, the system under test and QEMU and the backend, all of them continue running, but the tests actually block. So you do an assert screen on Xterm. This might take a while, depending on what happened else. Or you do assert screen system booted, and then you reboot, and then assert screen waiting for the booted desktop. And this can take minutes, but in between, this call will just block. So after you have the assertion that the Xterm is there, you type some string. You don't care how long this takes and what it does. And in the end, you do assert screen on hello typed, which means once the string in the font is rendered in the font you're expecting, it will actually pass. All these three commands are blocking calls. And what happens in the background, if I jump back to the architecture that I should have copied, ISO2 video will get the command from the test runner that there's supposed to be an assert screen. ISO2 video will pass some commands to the backend to prepare the reference screen on the needles matching to it, and then will continuously polling the backend if it found something in the current screenshot. And only when the backend says there's a timeout or there is a match found, it will pass back to the test runner the result. And in between, it will await commands from that, what you see as commands there, in case the web UI decided to inject new needles or the tester said stop on the web UI, and all this happens in the ISO2 video program. This is what I named here as an event loop, and the actual grabbing the screen from VNC, the actual check the needles database, check the the needle comparison that we just saw, all this happens in the backend process. And the backend process is also the one that has to take care that we grab a screenshot regularly from the VNC and pipe it into the video so that we are later on can have a regularly continuous video so that every frame also is a repeated number of time. So, actually the last thing I have are consoles. Consoles are a very important concept to support other platforms. When we had only QEMU, it was, or QEMU-like emulations. It was really easy to just have send key Alt+F2 to switch to another console or open an Xterm. So we had all these send keys that are very Linux specific or QEMU specific even. But now we have consoles that you can drive through the test API. So you do select console, user console, and depending on the platform you are on, you will either switch to Alt+F2 Linux console or to some Xterm that has some SSH connection open to the system under test, or the other console would be root console, or we have log console, or we have, I don't know, they have tons of consoles. And the QEMU consoles that we have are all so-called TTY consoles. They are bound to one specific Linux terminal, but they are only second most used. The one that is most prominent in QEMU tests is called SUT, and this is the one that actually talks VNC to QEMU. So this is the one that does the assert screens. This is the one that will type string into the currently selected TTY console, and so on. And that's what brings us to the last point on the slide, that these consoles can be stacked. So we have a TTY console that is actually connected to the SUT console, because if you do type string, it will type into the TTY console, but actually use the SUT console to do this over VNC. And there are other examples where we have this X3270 terminal that is running in some local XVNC. There's also a console and so on. Really fast, shit. the example I just mentioned is where we have Xterms running locally on the worker as part of the backend process that will actually drive commands on another machine that you can't see because it's somewhere remote and we don't have a video of it. But a local XVNC makes it possible that we can actually talk VNC to that console as well. So we can see what is typed locally in this terminal and then have a video of it, and we can assert screen. But when we do assert screens on this local Xterm running the commands on a remote machine, it's more complicated. That's why I put it at the end. But the key thing is that the tests that you write are very, very similar to what you had for QEMU. So when we introduced this IPMI backend to test real hardware, we had to change one test that was actually booting the system. And after that, we could use the same installation tests that we had before, that were asset screening, send type, and so on. And when we introduced, or when we worked on S390 support, it was a bit more complicated, especially as we had to introduce the console handling at all. But in the end, most of the tests are shared between all platforms. So, and this is some benefit that we have now. We can test, let's say, almost every hardware with the same set of tests, as long as we have SSH connection to it, and we can power cycle it. This is the VNC part that I mentioned initially for having as common factor between the backends is lost then, but we will use some local Xterm to have the screen. But for we can boot the machines remotely, we can install them remotely, we can test things on them remotely. This is all things we can drive, so we don't need a lot from the hardware to be tested, as long as we don't need to see that it's video. But for servers, this is the perfect match, and this is brings even more test capabilities to the system. Good. This leaves us 5 minutes for answers. Any questions for that? Anton, here. I think someone has to press here.
Test.
Ah, okay.
I have a question regarding comparing needles. You describe the algorithm my question is probably this task comparing two images is solved by many different ways. This algorithm is something which is developed inside the OpenQA, or it's some reuse of some existing algorithm? And in both cases, if you answer yes or no, why you select this way of doing comparison?
I must admit, I did not really understand the question, partly because of the audio and partly because of your pronunciation, sorry.
The question is the algorithm which you're using to comparing needles.
Yeah.
This algorithm is something generic used outside OpenQA tool, or it's something developed inside OpenQA for solving this problem?
Oh, the algorithm that we use to have to do this. So this is basically the backbone of the whole needle matching. This is based on OpenCV's template matching. So if you Google for OpenCV template matching, you will find other examples of people using this. For example, autonomous test cars driving. They also do something very similar. Not sure if they use OpenCV, but something very similar to detect traffic signs. So when you drive, they have all these cameras in your cars, and they will detect traffic signs, just as we are detecting needles. A bit more complicated, because they also have to adapt to having different viewpoints. So if you're coming from this side of the traffic sign, you still have to detect it than if you come from this side. But it's basically the same algorithms there.
Thank you.
Hi, I must admit that I don't have a very deep knowledge with OpenQA, but wouldn't it be possible to use something like OCR you know what OCR is, to detect fonts, circumvent the pixel matching? Do you know what I mean?
The fact is, we did some experiments with that. Actually, Bernhard started with that, and we continued with that. But the fact is that OCR is just as unreliable as this thing is. And if you have to train the OCR engine for every font change, you have the same problem there than we have right now. The advantage of OCR would be that, for example, during installation, you have tons of text scrolling through, and there's no really good way to detect an error, for example, or a warning that you want to assert that there's no warning scrolling through. And if you had OCR, you could actually make that happen. But the problem is, as long as OCR is so unreliable as it is right now, or most likely ever will be, if you ask me, the chances that you will miss these warnings is just as slim as currently. So that's why OCR sounds reasonable, but it's not so well suited in practice. For console tests, we don't do it at all, and for GUI testing, we don't care about the text so much. So that OCR is a lot of investment, and there is support for it, but as whenever someone finished the support or bug fixed it to work again, she soon realizes that it's not really worth it, and then it bit rots again in the code base. So we use Tesseract for that, which is already a quite good OCR engine, and I use it for private projects where you can train on the font used, for example, in my case, in a dictionary. But for having text in a random screenshot, it's just not suited.
Thanks.
Okay. If there are no more questions, I'm done after exactly half an hour. Thank you for your patience.